phone, all the way down from Delhi, and rushed straight in here, the third person who entered here. So here.
Thank you. I could not come, right? Because Apurva is special. There's no doubt about that. You know, when you watch that AV, you know exactly why this book works. Because that's exactly the tone of the book. It's telling you stuff that you sort of know at the back of your head. But I have two boys. I know I've woken up with guilt enough times. And being boss, when you're feeling guilty about your children back home, is complicated. It's like saying, on the one hand, you're supposed to be in control and authoritative and do the things that you're supposed to do. And then you go back home and something happens. You just sort of switch off and a different person emerges who screams and shouts and does all the wrong things, because there you can be out of control. And that's not really the best way to live. But most women I know do this. The thing about Apurva's book is also that a lot of people ask, what's different about it? Like, everyone's talking about Lean In. Everyone talks about Sheryl Sandberg and how everyone's writing books about being in the corporate space. I think the difference is that Apurva speaks from the heart in a way that none of the others have done. But she balances that heart with a lot of practical, sensible, not advice, I don't think that's the right word, but just experience. People she's met, people she's worked with, her own life and experiences. And you know, the thing that really endeared me to you, Apurva, when I first met you and we talked about plans, was that you said to me, edit really hard, do whatever it takes to make it work. I've given the book only to my husband and my son, and they're my harshest critics. And they have said, there's too much of this and there's too much of that. Cut it down. And I really trust what my husband and my son say to me. She said that, and I thought, okay, here's a woman writing about being woman, but she has people at home that she trusts enough, and they're male, and you don't trust males usually, but she trusts them. That means something is right in the way she deals with her relationships and with work and with the men in her life. Now, that's an unusual balance. And also that she was, of course, saying, edit as hard as you can. A lot of writers love their words. They don't like anything touched. They don't like anything changed. A lot of journalists here will know, when you're working on copy, how hard it is and how much they shout at you when you do things. She's been an angel to work with. Not so much her marketing team. They've been driving us really hard. They've been angels as well, but very hardworking angels. And they make sure everything is perfect in a very different way from her idea of perfection in the book. But it's been such joy to work on this. And I'm really hoping that 75,000 number was very sweet. We didn't publish that book. But someday I hope we'll stand here and say, you know, that second book, that sold over 100,000 copies. So, so on that note, thank you very much for being here on behalf of all of us and Apurva. And I do hope you will pick up that book and read it and gift it. Give it to all the women you know, but more importantly, give it to all the young men you know and the boys. And sometimes some older men, if you wish. They're too late. It's too late for them. So thank you again, and over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Kartika. And I have to say, the first gentleman, you were number three, the first gentleman that walked in here was her husband. So a big round of applause for him standing silently there, supporting absolutely everything. You know, this is a book read, and you know, normally we have a very silent, quiet, laid back, and you're reading a book. But this is a book that, you know, is very real, as so many of us would know, and we'd, you know, we feel like we're in that book. We're trying to figure out, is that us that she's talking about? Maybe not. But yeah, there's a lady I want to call on stage. You know, I'm, you know, how I mentioned I was in awe of Apurva Purohit. We've been in awe of her acting for years. Her life story is fantastic. When she comes on screen, there's this power that's there. You know, she needs no introduction when she walks on stage, but I still want to say this. You know, there's so many actresses that have come and have gone, and she's been here for so many decades, and when she reads with the power, which you will see right now, you will just feel every word that Apurva Purohit has written. When Divya Dutta, ladies and gentlemen, will be reading, I'd like to call her on stage. To be wonderful and beautiful as always. Please take center stage. But you know, before I say anything, I mean every word I say. Every time I meet you, I say this. Power has been, you know, has changed definition wise over the years, in Bollywood especially, you know, even in the corporate space. You know, whenever we've met over the years, you've seen how your roles have changed, where the lady's word is so strong and you're one of the strongest voices in Bollywood. Would you say something about that also? How, you know, this book also represents that you are the boss now as well. So how do you feel like, you know, with this big change that has happened also in so many years being in Bollywood? Yeah,
hi, very good evening. Jab tak mic haath mein na lagta nahi ki mic hai, you're talking. Congratulations, Apoorva. I think this is an amazing book, especially for working women. Because, you know, for us, it's very difficult to strike a balance. You sometimes don't know where you belong. Ki aap ghar ko dekhein, ki bahar dekhein, aur sabko push karein. You sometimes have to kind of undersell yourself. Sometimes you have to oversell yourself. You don't know what you're doing, really. But I think life teaches you, men teach you. And we somewhere, I think, kind of make our way. I think we're kind of in a nice place now. And this book, I think, Lady or the Boss, I think is going to be very relevant for all the women here, especially the working ones. And I think inspire every woman to not feel guilty, but not guilty. I feel guilty about everything. I feel guilty about being late, about not performing well, about not doing what I'm supposed to do at home. So I think this kind of is going to cut off the guilt that we have. Enjoy ourselves and just be very comfortable in our skin, being who we are.
And that's why you're going to start things off. She's reading the very first, which chapter are you going to be reading for us?
I am reading the first.
The very first chapter, ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause. Our book reading is starting. I'd like to have you, would you like to stand here? Would you like to, so that the people at the back could look back.
Yeah? Ready? You want me to up?
Yeah, that would be nice. Oh, wonderful. Thank you.
Punjabi, yeah.
And I'm going to give you a spot. There we go.
Can I have the slide, please? A minimum life. He says you are too much. You talk, laugh, smile, feel too much. But baby, here is the real problem. He's too little to appreciate that it took an entire galaxy being woven into one soul to make you. That's Nikita here. Centuries ago, our cave-dwelling ancestors began a pattern of behavior that seems to be continuing to this day in workplaces across the world. In those days, men had to go out to hunt while women stayed in their caves to care for the children and the elderly, and thus each behaved in a way that aided them best in their respective roles. The men donned masks and body paint, puffed up their chests, yelled battle cries, and made themselves larger than life to intimidate their prey. The women, sharing a small living space with so many others, shrank themselves as much as they could to cooperate with each other and to avoid communal strife. Thousands of years of evolution later, many things have changed. For example, men and women alike leave their homes to earn a living, but some things have not. The brunt of the care for children and the elderly is still shouldered by women. But the most puzzling and changed status quo is that men still don their metaphorical war paint and puff up their chests with aplomb while women continue to shrink themselves to take up as little space as possible, despite the fact that they are going a hunting too. A male sales head will confidently proclaim that he has achieved his target, even if the reality is that he has barely scrambled past the 80% goalpost. A company of 500 employees become 1,000 and a 2 crore salary becomes 4 when the story is being told by a lad. A fellow just about competent to be a marketing head will declare himself entirely ready to be a CEO. And I'm yet to come across the CV of any Indian male in which he hasn't asserted that he was the captain of his university cricket team and always was a topper to boot. All is bluff and bluster and par for the course in the day of a macho corporate Zorro. I have learned to moderate any grandiloquent statements the gentlemen around me make. What worries me, however, is that women too have not evolved significantly from their cave-dwelling selves. They have been shrinking and subduing themselves from time immemorial and continue to operate at subpar visibility levels even in contemporary times. We brush aside compliments, don't speak up, speak hesitantly when we do, never ask for raises, negotiate superbly on behalf of others, but never for ourselves, and let others take credit for our work. Despite being a senior role or promotion based on merit, we continue to behave as if we don't actually deserve to be there, and deem that the roles of sales head, CEO, managing partner, or principal are way above our station. Sadly, it is not just our cave-dwelling ancestors who should be blamed for our public mousiness. It is also the way we have been brought up and are bringing up our daughters, by censoring and diminishing them to be lesser than they are. We train our daughters to take up as little space as possible, not laugh aloud, or dress flamboyantly, or do anything that draws attention. We do it for their sake, to protect them, but unintentionally and wretchedly end up teaching them that to be invisible is good for them. Then how can we expect them to behave differently when they grow up? We may live in a world that trains us into silence, but fortunately, we live in times when we know not to take such instructions silently. To begin with, let us fight strong, talk loud, laugh hard, and assert ourselves without it. Let us take up as much space as we want, stand tall, and walk upright with pride. Let us live unabashedly, loudly, and wholeheartedly. A life lived in fear is an abbreviated, feeble life, and that life is not for you. A woman who has the whole universe residing within her. Apurva, that thank you. House, oh, there my boys, Pallu, and I make a faux pas. No pictures, please. Okay, so I think she set the mood for it. I have a little something very personal for you. There's a little poetry that's gone viral too, but it is all for the working women and what they want from their men. If you want, I can just share it, but this is dedicated to Apurva today. Tumne kaha tha hum ek hi hain, to apne barabar kar do na. Nappy jab main badalti hun, tum doodh ki botal bhar do na. Bas yun hi ek hai karke kahan zindagi chalti hai. Kabhi tum bhi sar daba do mera, ye bhi kami ek khalti hai. Jab main bhi office jaati hun, तुम भी घर को सवार दो ना, तुमने कहा था हम एक ही हैं, तो अपने बराबर कर दो ना, मत करो वादे जन्मों के, इस पल खुशी की वजह दो ना, कभी बाजारों से ध्यान हटे, तो मकान को घर भी कर दो ना, आओ पास बैठो, कुछ बातें करो, कभी दिल के जख्म भी भर दो ना, क्यों कहना भी पड़ता है, तुम एहसासों को समझो ना, तुमने कहा था हम एक ही हैं, तो अपने बराबर कर दो ना. तुम क्रिकेट भी अपनी देखो और मैं सीरियल अपना भी लगाऊंगी. तुम थोड़ा हाथ बटा देना, मैं जब किचन में जाऊंगी. सब मिलकर हाथ साथ करने की हमने ये भी तो क्वालिटी है. हम साथ खड़े हैं एक दूसरे के, हर ही जेंडर क्वालिटी है. तुम भी नए से हो जाओ अब और नई सी मुझको उम्र दो ना. तुमने कहा था हम एक ही, बस यूं ही जीवन बसर होना. So here's to women liberation, here's to working women, and here's to all the men who support these women and equally love them. And here's to me, my lovely lady, who is the boss, Apurva. This is for you, and have a great night. Thank you
so much, Divya. Thank you. Thank you so much. That was the real cherry on the cake, and we barely started eating the cake. It's fantastic. Okay, we're going to call a gentleman on stage because his book, there were some chapters in this book when you know, we were going through it. I mean, you wouldn't know if it was just, because it's for a boss, so if it was you or it was a lady boss, it would all be the same. Now, this gentleman is very special to a lot of Indians. In fact, all the billions of Indians across the world. I remember the 1990s when cable television was barely there. We'd be stuck with this radio. India, Sri Lanka. India's about to win. I could hear this voice. I saw this, you know, this gentleman out there, and we were learning about him, who was just becoming this big voice of cricket in our country. From then to now, there has been only one voice for me in this country. Whenever they say Harsha Bhogle, I say thank you, sir, for giving us this voice. Thank you for being the voice of cricket. And brilliant cricketer himself, and a fantastic, fantastic writer. I'd like to call him on stage. The one and only, ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause, Mr. Harsha Bhogle.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. So like I said, we go back a long way with you. You were the leader for all of us.
You don't look old enough to go a long way back.
And I'd rather. we're fixing it up rather well. But like I said, this, you have been the leader for all of us, you know, and there's a leadership chapter we'd love for you to read. But how does it feel when they say, you know what, you'll have the Bill Lauries of the world and you'll have all those names, but for me and for so many out here, it was always Harsha Bhogle, the voice of cricket.
Listen, it's hard to say you're a leader when the title of the book is Lady, You're the Boss. I started in advertising. My first boss was a lady. And then I work with Anita, and my second boss is a lady. So I have no clue about leadership. I only talk, I only tell people what I see. But yeah, I think leadership is a very, very important aspect in my profession. Even in T20, we now say that a leader is worth two players. But in the corporate world, you'll know when I read this bit.
Please, the stage is all yours.
Thank you. Stand up there, is it?
Yes, so okay. That I can throw a spot on you.
Yeah. Okay, because when we were in school, standing on a chair was considered punishment. Okay, so I asked Apoorva, what am I going to read? And she said, a 200 is not scored very often. Did you ever score a 200, a double 100? I said, start from 200. So the chapter is called Culture Vultures. She's a culture, she got a vulture to read it. Okay, so here we go.
Now the stage is truly yours, man. But like I said, that was the most animated I'd seen you, and that is fantastic. But yeah, you will be, of course, reading right at the end, and like the epilogue in the end. Be wonderful. Would you like to stand up there, or?
Yes, I can.
Can I give you a hand?
Yes, please.
Wonderful, man.
Always good to hold the hand of a good-looking guy, right?
And then we'll chat more with you, man, but we'll leave this stage to you. And it's her time. A big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. You have a big number to beat, ma'am. 75,000 has to be broken.
Yes, yes. Okay. So I'm going to read the epilogue, which sort of summarizes, in a sense, the entire book. So it goes as such. What is the measure of your ambition? Would you like to weigh your life against diamonds and pearls and other markers of wealth? Or would you prefer to measure it on a speedometer in terms of the number of activities completed in a day or a month? Maybe the number of frequent flyer miles you collected as you whisked through 265 days of travel every year? Perhaps you would like to assess it in terms of the happiness you gave your family, in the nurturing of two lovely children, and the loving care you took of your parents as they aged in front of your eyes. Will the fact that you gave up the rat race for the passion of teaching, traveling, or writing be your epitaph? At the time of the final judgment, will you rest your case of being successful on the evidence of having built a fine organization or a boutique firm from scratch, or the number of close and lasting friendships you had? To every one of us is given the choice of what scale we want to gauge our life against, and then decide how well we performed on it. This book is not a guide or lesson on whether the choices you made or the goals you sought were right or wrong, good or bad. I wrote this book to tell you that you and you alone should have the power and the authority to make that choice. Without the baggage of expectations, without the affliction of being seen as a woman in a largely male-dominated world, without the conditioning that was injected in your veins and the veins of your mother and grandmother. Only you should decide who you are and what you want to become. And as you stand and look at yourself in the mirror and reclaim your agency to make that choice, this book, as all good catalysts do, tells you what to stop, start, and continue doing. So stop saying yes when you mean no. It is okay to say maybe too when you're not sure. Stop being that patient listener of the pompous male voices around you. Stop putting everyone else's needs before you. Stop jumping up to make the coffee when you're the only woman in the room. Let out that curly hair from that oil plant. Unlayer that dusky skin from the industrial level coatings of the latest fairness cream. And don't worry if you're the only soprano in a room full of baritones and basses. Revel in being different and owning your true self. Finally, start standing straight and tall, talking loudly and laughing voicelessly. The default background score in our public and private spaces is deafeningly male. You need to change that. Your invisibility and your silence have been your biggest weaknesses. You are wise, you are talented and bright, but you have not been bold, you have not been bold or clear. It is time you stood up to be counted. Display your legs and cleavage at your will. and ask the gentleman standing next to you not to peer down your neckline. If he can stare openly, you can tell him to not do so openly too. If you disagree with your board members, say so in the boardroom itself and don't hide behind one-on-one chats. Start letting go of your children, the wounds in your past, the organization that did not give you growth or paid you less than your male colleagues, and even your desire to feel needed or to get married if you don't want to. You have the entire universe inside you. So why do you allow yourself to be condensed or minimized into a microcosm? As you practice, so will you become. So practice the swagger. Practice being flamboyant and confident. Practice walking with a sway of your hips, a song on your lips, and laughter in your heart. Practice, practice, practice this. Henceforth and more. And as you reclaim your true position on this planet, remember you're giving strength to other women too. When they watch you, they will learn. And when they learn, they will grow. That is the only way we will quicken the pace of change and begin to hold up half the sky that rightfully belongs to us, one woman holding up one corner of it at a time. The sisterhood coming together in a shared culture of kindness, nurturing and support is the only way to dismantle the existing patriarchal norms, and you cannot let your community down by remaining a passive bystander. When you unleash the leader in you, I hope this book and the points I'm leaving behind with you allow you to reflect on how it will help you maximize your real potential in its highest and truest form and give you all that your heart desires, in whichever form or shape you have chosen to bring these yearnings to alive. From one sister to another, may the force be.
Lovely man. I'm going to bring you back down. And if you could just, we've got a little poem that we want to show you. A lovely one that was said a while back by Divya, but this one's really nicely done, and there are a few participants also in the audience that are there part of this. Keep a look around, you might just see a few of them. So let's dim the lights and I want to show you that.
On this special day that all my friends, colleagues, family is here to share this moment. So thank you so much. Thank you for the wonderful team of Varsha, Priyanka, Megha, who's the writer and director of that poem that you just saw, and all of you here. Thank you so much. The bar is open. The only way this works, however, is that you buy the book, then you go and show it, then you go and show it at the bar, and then you get a drink. Thank you so much.
Ma'am, do stay on stage. We've got a little photo op that we want to do. Harsha, sir, I'd like to call you back on stage. And this is when we do an actual photo op with the book as well. Rasika Duggal is with us as well. I'd like to call her on stage. And Kiran Mundral, a very, very well-known author, I'd like to call her on stage. And anybody else, ma'am, if you'd like to call on stage.
So I've got so many friends here. Yes. I don't know whom to call, but...
Right now, we'll stick to these audience. Yeah, I'm going to give you these books if you can hold it. Yeah, there you go. Wonderful. And yes, the bar, you can open. Yeah, on the side of the back.
There is Kiran.
Kiran.
Yeah, there we go. Let me give it. Yeah. There you go. No, no, ma'am. Illustrious company on stage. I'll have to stay aside. Right. Nice big smile, everyone.